or inclusive process. Now, even after so many years of our persistent efforts, still there are some sections still excluded from the education sector, particularly higher education also. So what are the initiatives required, or what are the improvements required, so that education also plays a very important role in bringing them, these people, into the development process of the country?
Well, this is a very important question that you ask, because one of the very important thing that comes out is that the lowest poverty is that of regular salaried, either in rural area or in urban area.
Yes.
Lowest salary.
Yes.
And which means that if you get a regular salary, either on a weekly basis, 6 monthly basis, yearly basis, you are assured of income and you are assured of consumption and low poverty.
Yes.
But to get a regular job, your employability has to be increased.
Yes.
So, and to be able to be employable, you ought to have skill and education.
Yes.
So, the link between the skill and vocational education and education and employment and income and poverty is very, very, very clear.
Yes.
And therefore, we focus on public employment, public education system for last 50-60 years, and education has been a vehicle of economic growth and reduction in the poverty. But in the recent year, after the early 90s, we sort of switching over from the public employment to privatization of higher education, and particularly the privatization of professional education. I have seen the national sample service figure at All India level. The percentage of students going to the self-employed private institutions. There are private institutions which are aided. And their cost of education is low. They are almost par with the government. But there are private which are unaided and self-employed, and they depend entirely on tuition for a source of income. It is this private unaided self-financing institution, and bulk of them are in private, in professional courses. There the proportion of the student going to this was 7% in 1995. Now it is close to 1/4. In some of the state it is about 40%, 50%. And that is an expensive education. And therefore, it has affected the access of a poor. I have seen the enrollment ratio in the private self-financing institution by social group and by income categories. And clearly, the poorer have a much less access because tuition is very high. So I think this is going to create a problem for us, that those who are poor will have a less access to professional education, their capacities will be expanded less, and their employability will be reduced compared to the others. So education might become a source of inequality. Education is a source of equality, in fact. That you expand the capacities of everybody, improve their employability, and let them then take the chances in the market. But here, to begin with, we create unequal capacity enhancement, and as a result, there is a problem. Government is aware about it. It's not that they are not aware. A state like Karnataka, Maharashtra are paying the tuition fees for scheduled castes and scheduled tribes to the private institutions. Central government, MHRD, has started what is called finance corporation. But I think a good and viable model is yet to be discovered, in my view. There are models, for example, Canada model is very good. The loan and finance facility to the poor student for higher education is with the ministry. And ministry gives the loan to the students under the condition that after they get employment, they repay it in installment. There is a default rate of 5-10%, and that is fine. That goes as a subsidy, but everybody gets financial support. I think we are still, our loan mechanism is to commercial bank, which are in habit of asking for a security.
So many documents and procedures.
So I think we have to work on a model which will be done in a manner that every poor and meritorious who get admission is insured some amount of financial support.
Sir, another problem like a developing country like India is facing is the migration and proliferation of a large number of informal slum dwellers, and these are the people usually excluded from the development process. What are the special features of these slum people or the urban poor people, and how the inclusive process should be made so that these people can be brought back to the inclusive development?
Well, long back, I think 6-7 years before, I had written my book on slum. Urban slum, that was a study on metropolitan Delhi along with my colleague Dr. Sudesh Nangia. I think essentially what is that slum, people in the slum are nothing but who are pushed over from the rural areas. It's a push migration. You have no opportunities in rural area. You also face discrimination and violence.
Yes.
So you move out to the cities. And these are essentially the persons who are with a unskilled manure laborer who land up in the slums. And their problems are a lot more acute. They don't have skill. The access to education is much lower. Even if they are in rural area, at least they will go into primary school. But in urban area, there is a problem. So the problem of slum dwellers in terms of employment and poverty and housing and civic amenity are a lot more serious. Although in majority of the state and at the center, there are schemes for the slums for in terms of giving housing, in terms of other facilities.
Yes.
But they are the one who are the people who are really at the margin.
Yeah. Sir, finally, I would like to know how the Food Security Act has come, wherein government is providing food security. And also there is a Land Acquisition Act is passed, so that some kind of compensation is paid.
Mm.
How this kind of broad framework is important or necessary, or how it is going to influence kind of an equitable, just developmental process?
Oh, of course. The Food Security Act will provide, access to food to the poor.
Yeah.
See, the point is that the growth, which and pro-poor growth,
yes,
which lead to increase in the income of the poor, also help to reduce poverty.
Yes.
But this has two aspects. One is that it takes time. And secondly, that some benefit, even among the poor, some may not benefit. Some may have employment, some may not have employment. So it does help, but it takes time. And poverty and starvation is something which you cannot wait.
Okay.
And therefore, I think we have realized that we at least should provide a minimum amount of food to the poor people. And this is not a new strategy. I think we are having an fair price shop much early 70s, and but now we take on responsibility that this is the right of the people, and that this is the duty of the government, at least to those who do not have, provide the minimum food so that they have something to eat. I think how to do it, there can be a difference of opinion, whether you should have PDS and through PDS we should distribute food, or we should have cash coupon, or you should have cash transfer. These are the issues which are debated. But one of the issues which nobody denies and dispute is that we have to follow an interventionist policy whereby we provide a certain amount of food to the poor people. And then this is also in combination with the NAREGA, employment.
Yes.
One of the important aspects which we have not realized and which we must realize is the following. And that is that we have used our NAREGA scheme.
Yeah.
We can combine it with the food,
yes,
but we have used it mainly to create an infrastructure, road, electricity,
yes,
water and
yes,
others.
Yes.
We have not used it for growth purposes.
Okay.
We must use the NAREGA, which is a very important labor force available to us, to improve the productivity of
productivity,
the asset.
That is the main
leveling
thing
of land,
yes,
and conservation of water resources,
yes,
expansion of
yes
water resources,
yes,
and many other things.
Yes.
So it will have an productivity, in fact.
Okay.
I mean, this is counted as a subsidy, but the money that you spend on food, money that you spend on employment in NAREGA, if it leads to increase in the productivity of agricultural land and other productivity, then it is giving you return.
Okay.
But that we have not yet realized sufficiently enough, that we are scared that, if it is used for development of the asset on the private land, it might be misused. But we have to find out the ways.
Okay.
I think my suggestion would be here that I think we have a golden opportunity to use the NAREGA labor for land leveling, for water conservation, for increasing the irrigation facility. But what we have to do it, instead of focusing on one farm, we can have agroclimatic region.
Okay.
We have to have agronomists and engineer who for a region as a whole plan
for it. Yes.
The land leveling, drainage,
and
watershed, and also irrigation development facility. So if we do that based on the agroclimatic region and use this labor that is available to us, I think it will have a huge growth impact and productivity enhancing impact. And the gain from that growth might more than compensate the money that we spend on food and money that we spend on NAREGA.
Driver rather than
How to use NAREGA for the growth is a key issue which we have to plan, I think.
Right. Sir, finally, government is doing a lot of efforts, and we know that for the don't you think the private sector and the corporates have a responsibility towards an inclusive growth strategy, at least some kind of a specific measures they can, so that can complement the whatever efforts the government is taking.
Oh, indeed, I think corporate sector is has a responsibility in the sense that major sector is the private sector, your agriculture and the non-agriculture. Well, government has now passed changes in the Companies Act, where 2% of your profit has to be put for the corporate social responsibility. And I think this money will be used by the corporate sector for the poor. Unfortunately, we have a very weak tradition of philanthropy in this country compared to US and Europe. Therefore, the philanthropy comes to a modification in the Companies Act. But that's okay. I think the private sector will, I hope, will come forward. Yeah.
Sir, thank you so much. You have shed so much of light on certain very, very important policy dimensions of inclusive growth. It's a pleasure talking to you, sir.
Well, thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.